I grew up in the town of Glenarden, the little town of Glenarden, Maryland. As I grew up in Glenarden, there was one particular thing that bothered me greatly during the course of my growing up years. That thing was this thing called death. Death bothered me. It troubled me. I viewed it as the worst thing that could happen in a person's life. What appeared to me when I saw somebody die or heard of somebody dying, it appeared to me that that was the end of the story, the end of their lives, the end of their existence. So to me, it was a terrible, horrifying thing. And so for a great portion of my childhood, I grew up horrified at the thought of dying. There was a sting to death. It was painful. My perspective of death was heightened when my grandfather, who lived with us when I was growing up, suddenly died from a heart attack. My grandfather, who had been there every day of our lives, living in Glenarden, growing up in our same home, one day had a heart attack and died. And then to walk into the room where he once was, where he sat, where he watched TV, where he did the things that he did, and he was no longer there, was devastating to me. It was further complicated, my perspective of death was further complicated when one of my schoolmates, Gary Johnson, decided to play on the railroad tracks, played chicken with a train, and lost the bet. It was horrifying to go to Gary's funeral as we watched this young man who was young, vibrant, full of life, lose his life at a moment from a foolish choice and act. My great-grandmother lived with us too. There she was, almost 90 years old, and she died. The pain of these deaths touched me and impacted me tremendously. It really did something that I really wasn't prepared to do. It made me come to grips with the reality that I too had to examine my own morality. I don't know whether you thought about it or not, but the reality of the fact is everybody in here one day will have to die. Let me say that one more time, because I should have got a few more amens. I know you haven't thought about it. I know you don't want to dream about it. I don't know you don't want to face it. But the reality is, everybody in here one day has to die. I'm sure that many of you today have already experienced the trauma of somebody dying, and it's been devastating to you. Some of you have people that you've loved and cared for who died. Perhaps a relative, a friend, someone close to you, and they died. If you have not yet had that experience, keep living. I promise you, it's coming down your road. But I wonder if you've ever thought about the fact, what will happen when you die? We'll all have to face death, we'll have to go, and we will have to face the assignment that one day we will have to die. Have you ever wondered? As a matter of fact, have you ever wondered that there will be a day in history that will be your last day on the planet? Have you ever thought about that? Have you ever thought about the reality that that day could be today? Let me ask the question again, since y'all didn't answer it. Let me ask you one more time. Maybe you haven't. It could be today. Today could be your last day on the planet. It could be the last day that you would spend with your family. The last day to drive your nice car. The nice day to put on your, the last day, it could be the last day to put on your nice dress, the last day to speak to your spouse, the last day to be with your children, the last day to hug your mom or your daddy. The day could be your last day to go to that job that you can't stand. It doesn't matter your age, doesn't matter your economic status, it doesn't matter your educational level. Death approaches everybody. Everybody's gonna have to face death, and death will come into your life. No, it doesn't care how much money you have, how much education you have. Death does not care what you have left undone. Death doesn't care about your to-do list. Death doesn't care that you haven't filled out your Outlook. You haven't filled out the task. You haven't completed what you got on your task to do in Outlook. Don't care that you plan on buying the iPhone. It don't care about the new car that you just bought. Death doesn't care. Have you ever thought about the fact that today could be your last day? Some folks were a specimen of good health, walking around, nothing wrong with them. I'll tell you what something happened. In this week, in the last 7 days at the First Baptist Church of Glenarden, the last 7 days, three of our members have died who went to sleep and never woke up. They weren't in any car accident. Nobody broke into their house and took their life. There was nothing drastically wrong with them. They laid down to go to sleep, to take some rest, and never woke up. They didn't have a chance to get it together. They didn't have a chance to say, okay, Jesus, I'm about to die. Fix me up. Let me get saved now. They didn't have time. And the reality of the fact is some of you are betting on the chance that you're going to have an opportunity at the end of your life to get everything straight at the last minute. And my assignment in these next few moments that I have is to shout and sound the alarm and tell you that tomorrow is not promised. Life is not promised to anybody. Some folks have lost their life in sleep. Some have been killed in accidents. Some folks have had their lives tragically taken away by some deranged person. The only thing you have is this moment. This minute. It's only 60 seconds in it. Forced upon you. Can't refuse it. Didn't seek it, didn't choose it, but it's up to you to use it. You must suffer if you lose it, give an account if you abuse it, just a tiny little minute, but 60 seconds, an eternity is in it. That's Willie Jolly, that's not me. 60 seconds, one 60-second span, you will make a decision that will determine your eternal status. As a matter of fact, in the next, I got 11 60-second segments. I'm going to take more than that, but I'm supposed to be finished at 11 o'clock. But in these next 60-second segments, I have the responsibility to try to challenge you to make a choice and a decision that will determine your destiny. I'm going to give it the best I have, but it's going to be up to you to decide what you're going to do about the fact that one day you're going to die. One day you will breathe your last. As a matter of fact, death is no new thing to God. God has a lot to say about death. It's no new thing. Matter of fact, God had death in mind at the beginning before he even made the world. As a matter of fact, when he screwed the stars in their sockets and when he created the sun and flung it out there and told it to hang there and shine, when he spoke the worlds into existence, when he kneeled on the side of the hill and scooped into the dust of the earth and formed man and blew in his nostrils the breath of life, when he reached into Adam's side and ripped out a rib and created his soulmate and created his wife and blew life into her, when he made Adam and Eve, he had death in mind. It's no new concept to God. It's not new to him. As a matter of fact, you say, well, Pastor Jenkins, how do you know he had death in mind? I know he had death in mind because he said to Adam and Eve when he put them in the garden, he said, all of this is yours. I want you to have dominion and domain. I want you to rule and I want you to control and I want you to have domain over the planet. I want you to name the animals and I want you to eat of the land and I want you to do this. But he said, this one tree, I don't want you to eat from that tree. You can have everything else. You can do anything else you want. But this one tree, don't eat of it. But you know what they did? They went right to the tree that God told them not to go to. Isn't that amazing? The kids will go right to the thing you tell them don't do. I'm trying to figure out, maybe I should try to use some reverse psychology on my kids. And instead of trying to get them to do what I don't want them to do, maybe I should tell them not to do the things that I want them to do. I'm gonna try it out. I'm gonna say, don't make up that bed. Don't you clean up that room. Leave that room a mess. Put that broom down. I told you about sweeping that floor. Because it seems like all the things I tell them to do, they don't do. And the things I tell them not to do, that they do. Come on, talk to me for just a second. Anybody know what I'm telling you to? I think we ought to have a week this week of telling our kids. We should try. We should try collectively. All the parents should just try telling your kids to do the stuff that you don't want them to do it. Tell them to do it. Go on. Go on, drink. Go ahead. Smoke. You want me to buy you a pack of cigarettes? I don't come in tonight. Stay out all night long. Come back tomorrow sometime. Can we try to see what the results might be? God said to Adam and Eve, don't eat of that tree. I don't know how long they were in the garden. We don't have any idea how long they were in there. The Bible doesn't give us any indication of how long they were there. They could have been in there for hundreds, if not thousands of years. We don't know. But there did come a time when they violated what God told them not to do, and they ate of the tree. And here's what the Bible says. The day that you eat of it, here's what God said to them. The day you eat of it, you shall surely die. That's an amazing passage to me, because for God to say to them, the day you eat of the tree, you shall surely die, he wasn't playing around. But here's the problem I have. Eve ate, and then, being like a woman is, she led her husband down the wrong street. Come on, brothers, don't leave me hanging out here by myself. Come on, have some guts and say amen, bro. Come on. You know, some of these guys want to say amen, but they're scared. They're scared to say amen. She ate and then she gave it to him. And they didn't die. That blows my mind. But the scripture says in Genesis 2, God said, the day you eat of it, you shall die. That's because God's concept of death is different than ours. Our concept of death is a narrow perspective that we think death is narrowed down to the physical being of when a person physically loses their breath in this body. But God's scope of death and what death means is so much wider than just when a person physically dies. In the mind of God, there's two kinds of death. There's a physical death, but there's also a spiritual death. When Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden, they began to physically die that day. They didn't die, but they began to physically die. That marked the day when they started to die. But something worse than their physical death happened. You see, there are things worse than physical death. Something devastating happened that day, because they not only began to die physically, what happened to them on that day is that they got separated from God spiritually, and that's a far greater death. That's what's really death. That's what the sting of life is about, is to be alive but not to have life. To be going around the task but not having God in your life, not having God in your day-to-day activities, not having God to talk to, not having God to commune with, not having God open up doors, not having God answer your prayer. That's the devastating thing. Adam and Eve died two ways that day. They started physically dying, but they got separated from God. And some of you are living your lives today separated from God. You're dead and you don't even know it. You think that all that life is about is the parties that you attend and the cars that you drive and the house that you live in and the clothes that you wear. But I need to tell you that one day you're going to die and somebody else is going to be driving your car, dog. Somebody else is going to be living in your house. Girlfriend, let me tell you something. Girlfriend, hey, sister, girlfriend, can I tell you something? When you die, you're going to die. When you die, your husband, your man, your dude, your dog, I promise you, the day you die, after they lower you in the ground, his eyes is popped open looking someplace else. Y'all ain't got to say amen. I'm telling y'all the truth. And if the truth be told, if we were really to tell the truth, before your body go in the ground, he got his eyes open. Kind of quiet over on this section over here. You are going to die. And the ultimate question is, have you made the preparations to be ready for when you die? I'm not talking about orchestrating your will and writing in it, well, if I die, can't no other woman come into this house. Or I ain't talking about that. I'm talking about your status with God. I'm talking about whether or not you will have the ultimate question that Paul addresses in this passage resolved. Because what Paul says in verse 50, he says, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. You can't take your car to heaven. Can't take your clothes. Can't take your threads, your tailor-made suits, your hats, your ties. You can't take it. Your house ain't going there. All the stuff that's near and dear that you don't want nobody touching, you can't take it with you. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. He says, I'm going to tell you a mystery. We shall all be changed. We won't sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. I like this. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. I like that. Now he went through all of that dialogue to make this one thing plain to us, that if you are a Christian and you have accepted the Lordship of Jesus in your life, when you die, hallelujah, one day Jesus is coming back and he's going to blow the trumpet, and those who have died in Jesus will be raised into a brand new life with a brand new body to be able to go to heaven and live in eternity with God in his kingdom. It is at this point that Paul makes a startling revelation. He asks the question, oh, death, where is your sting? What a startling statement. What a startling statement. Oh, death, where is your sting? For him to stand up and look death in the face and say, death, you have taken a whole lot of people. You've destroyed a lot of things. You've hurt a lot of people. You've taken a lot of people down. You took Adam down, and you took Abraham down, and you took Moses down, and Noah and David and Solomon and Methuselah and Jacob and Joshua. And we can go on down the list of all the people you took out. But he says, he looks at death in the face and say, death, you have taken and you have defeated for such a long time. But he says to death, you have now lost the final battle and you cannot take us out. What are you talking about, Jenkins? Paul is talking about the reality of the fact is that when you accept the Lordship of Jesus and this earthly tabernacle of ours dissolves, we know that this is not the end of it. Hallelujah. When this earthly tabernacle dissolves, we have another building not made by the hands of man. We have another home. It's not all about what goes on down here. I don't know what y'all think about, but what I think about is my eternal place. I heard Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there ye may be also. He says, in my Father's house are many mansions. And he says, I'm going to get your mansion ready. Come on, somebody. I'm looking forward to getting ready to move to my mansion. A lot of folks tried to defeat death. Adam couldn't do it. Abraham's faith couldn't do it. Moses and all of his courage couldn't do it. Noah built the ark, but he couldn't defeat death. David was a great king, but he couldn't defeat death. Solomon had a lot of wisdom, but he couldn't defeat death. Methuselah lived for 969 years, but he couldn't outlast death. Jacob was a deceiver, but he couldn't trick death. Joshua was a mighty warrior, but he couldn't outfight death. And whatever you're good at, that thing that you're good at is not going to defeat death. You're going to die. But the glorious news of the kingdom is that Jesus has taken the sting out of death. I told my wife, if something happens to me, don't try to keep me hooked up to some contraption to keep me artificially alive. If I can't live by the functions that God gave me in my natural body, it means it's time for me to roll on. And guess what? I'm ready to roll on. If I perish, let me perish. I'm going on to meet the King. I can't get no help up in here. The folks who are fighting to stay alive and fighting to stay down here and fighting to keep life going and fighting to get into these little chambers and get yourself sucked up in the chamber eyes so you can keep on living and trying to extend your life. Oh yeah, I'm trying to live, but I ain't trying to be crazy. I'm trying to live while I'm living. But when this life is over, I'm ready to fly away. I can't get no help up in here. I'm ready to pass on to meet the King. Jesus, the glory of this day is that what Jesus did on the cross is he took the sting out of death. What Jesus did was defeat death once and for all. Death no longer had any more power or authority. It used to be in charge. It used to call the shots. It used to have all the say. But hallelujah, thanks be to God, when Jesus came and died on the cross and he buried it in the tomb, he did on that resurrection Sunday morning what no other power, no other human, no other person had ever done. He permanently conquered death. It is permanently conquered. So guess what? That means that when I die, I'm ready to meet Jesus. I will close my eyes on this side and open my eyes on that side in the presence of God. That means that when somebody that I love who knows Jesus died, I'm not going to be trying to crawl up into the casket with them. That was only the house that they lived in. They're just throwing this house off and picking up a brand new house in another place called glory. Thank you, 17 people, for that rousing. It's too late for the rest of you jokers. It's too late. So that brings me to this ultimate question. It's the question I got to ask everybody in this building. If today was your last day, if you walked out of here today and God forbid you dropped dead in the parking lot. By the way, we still going to have a 12 o'clock service after we move your body on out of here. We might as well tell the truth. I know they'll bring me a report that Pastor so-and-so died. They've gone on to the eternal resting place. I'll say, okay. All right, what time is the next service? Let's roll on. Y'all do want me to tell you the truth, don't you? Because if you've been listening to what we've preached and embraced the lordship of the only King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, we have no fear about death, because to be absent in the body means to be present with God. Amen. In order for me to pick up incorruption, I have to lay down corruption. In order for me to pick up immortality, we have to lay down mortality. In order for me to get to heaven, I got to lay down flesh and blood. In order for me to get to where Jesus is, I got to lay down this flesh. And the question I have to ask you today from the depths of my heart is, will the sting of death pain you? The answer for me is that the sting of death won't bother me, because he's taken the stinger out of death. I have confidence in that he who got up out of the grave, he did what nobody else has done, nobody else will ever do. He's the only, we know he's the only true God, because Jesus did a miraculous thing. He hung on the cross, he was beaten and whipped, and God took all of our sins and laid it on Jesus and punished him on our behalf. And he closed his eyes and he died, and they laid him in the tomb, and he laid in there for 3 days. But early on Sunday morning, early on a resurrection day, he got up out of the grave with all power in his hands. He lives. I don't know what y'all believe, but I believe he lives. I believe he's alive and well. And that's why I serve Jesus and not Buddha. That's why I serve Jesus and not Muhammad. That's why I serve Jesus and not Confucius. Because he did what nobody else did. He got up out of the grave. Hallelujah. And gave me life more abundantly and gave me a joy that is unspeakable and forgave me of my sin. Now, I don't know who you are, but here's what I know. I know that you're somewhere in this building that you're not right with God. And if you were to die today, the sting of death would be painful to you because you haven't gotten it right with God. But you got 1 minute, 60 seconds in it, didn't choose it, didn't whatever, the rest of that story. You got 60 seconds to make a choice that will determine your eternity. And my simple cry to you is if you're not right with God, get up out of your seat right now and get down to this altar and meet me right here right now and let's get right with God.
Today's dynamic message from Pastor Jenkins is one that has the power to change your life. But it can only do so if you have a heart and soul that belong to Jesus Christ. Perhaps you want to be able to make such a claim, but you don't know how. It's simple. You just have to confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins and rose again with all power. Your sins are now forgiven, and you're part of the family of God. Welcome. Maybe you're already saved and in need of a church home, one that will nurture your growth and development as a Christian. Or perhaps you were once in fellowship with God, but have since drifted away and are ready to return to your first love. Whatever the case, we'd love to have you become a part of the First Baptist family. Simply contact us at 301-773-3600 or visit our website at www.fbcglenarden.org for more information on any one of our four convenient services or our 100-plus ministries designed to meet your most intimate needs. First Baptist Church of Glenarden, where God is developing dynamic disciples.